Good morning.
Please pray with me. Dear Lord, as we gather today, we praise you for this day and for your purpose for it. Lift our eyes to seek you first today and refocus our hearts to you this morning so we can absorb everything you have put on Tim's heart to teach us this morning. Let our hearts overflow of thanks while we praise you for all that you have done for us. And now let us pray the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
I'd love to invite the children down at this time. Good morning, friends. So good to see everybody today. We have lots of friends making their way down. Good morning, good morning. As they're making their way down, I'd love to invite everyone today to come to Gaddy Land or Gaddy Town, whatever it is, in Ashland at 4:30. I hope you guys will be there. And also remind everyone, we have VBS coming up in June, so if you would like to volunteer, we'd love to have you. All right, how is everybody? Is everybody good? All right, well, what if I told you that we're going to have a basketball game right here, right now, and I'm ready and prepared. Are you ready to have a basketball game?
That's a baseball.
Oh, softball, isn't it? Well, also, do we have hoops in here? No, this is not a gym. This is not a basketball court. And this is not a basketball, is it? What if I told you instead of that, we'll do something even better. We will make cookies. Are you ready? Let's make our cookies. Is this all we need? That's a chili spoon. You're right. It's a ladle. It's a ladle. Do you even need this? Do you even need this to make cookies? No, we don't have what? The ingredients? We don't have an oven. We don't have a spoon or a bowl, right? We don't have anything we need to make cookies. This is not the right equipment, is it? Well, we can only do these things if we were prepared and equipped with the correct and things we need, right? Well, did you know that God equips us with exactly what we need in our lives for whatever he wants us to do? In the Old Testament, God spoke through special people called prophets. Can you say prophet?
Prophet?
Prophet, good job. Prophets were called by God to deliver messages and help people. Well, one of these prophets' name was Jeremiah. God called Jeremiah at a very young age, and he was really nervous because he did not think people would listen to him and trust him because he was just a kid. Do you think you'd feel like that? Would you feel nervous if God called you to do something like that and be like, I don't know if anyone will listen? Well, Jeremiah told God that he wasn't sure what to say or how. But God told Jeremiah that he had planned out this big task for his life before he was even born and had a special plan for him. God promised to be with him and give him the right words to say. He would make sure he had all he needed to do the job God had for him. And just like God had some mighty big plans for Jeremiah, he also has some pretty big plans for each of you too. He knows your name, Rennie. Did you know that? God knows your name. He knows all your names. And he knew you before you were even born. And he has a plan for your life. Old or young, big or small, God will equip us for whatever he has planned for us. He guides us and promises to always be with us, and God gives us the ability to do the things he asks us to. Did you know that, Rennie? And did you know that he knows what we really need, and he knows what we can do already? There's nothing impossible with prayer and faith. No one knows us like he does, because he made us and planned us for very special jobs. God provides for us and stays with us and will give us the equipment, the supplies, and the strength to do his work. Will you please pray with me? Dear God, thank you for helping us to do all the things you have called us to do. Please help us trust in you and look to you for strength and guidance. Amen.
All good gifts come from you, Lord, and from these riches we bring this offering. Help us to use it for the furtherance of your purpose in this place and for the benefit of those in need. Help us to be generous givers, dear Lord, both of our money and our lives, that we might make a difference in this town. Amen. Thank you.
As we go into a time of intercessory prayer, I want to bring to your attention those who are in need of our intentional prayers. We want to continue to pray for Joe Barnett. We want to continue to pray for healing mercies for Mary Lee Leslie. We want to continue to pray for those who are addicted and afflicted in our communities. And of course, we will leave time for you to bring your own private prayer concerns. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Blessed Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of mercy and grace. Bodies bent in awe of who you are and what you are doing in and amongst Fifth Avenue Baptist Church through us, your people, who cry out to you, Abba, Father. Hear our cries. Lord, for the people who are hurting, we ask that you walk with them, that you be with them, that you be with Joe as he's facing surgery, that you be with Mary Lee Leslie, Lord, that you be with the doctors and the nurses that's on her case, on their cases. But Lord, for those who are ill, who may have heard new diagnoses, who may be facing treatment, we ask that you walk with them, that you be a light into their path and a lamp into their feet in this time. Lord, we lift up to you this community. We ask that you be in and amongst Huntington, West Virginia, and its surrounding areas, that you continue to encourage us, your people, to be beacons of hope and light into a broken and dark world, that you continue to encourage us to find areas of need, opportunities to be your hands and feet. But Lord, we lift up to you now our pastoral search committee, our interim pastoral search committee, that you continue to guide them with your wisdom, that you continue to be with them. Lord, as your people crying out, Abba, Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit dwells with us here, that you encourage us, that our encouragement will flood the walls of Fifth Avenue Baptist, that people on the outside can see the hope we have in here, and that we share that hope with one another. Lord, we love you and we thank you for who you are. Lord, in this time, we lift up to you our own private prayer concerns. Lord, you are faithful and just, full of mercy and grace, and we thank you. Amen.
I'm going to sing. I'm going to sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing when the Spirit says sing.
I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing when the Spirit says sing. And obey the Spirit of the Lord.
I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing
when the Spirit says sing. I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing when the Spirit says sing.
I'm going to sing.
I'm going to sing when the Spirit says sing. And obey the Spirit of the Lord.
I'm going to pray.
Oh.
Amen. Thank you, choir. So I'm kind of treating this as the last of my introductory sermons, and I thought it was appropriate to preach about my theology about preaching, as at least for a couple of months, a few months, I'll be here with you on many Sunday mornings in this task of preaching a sermon. From the book of Jeremiah, the first chapter, beginning with the fourth verse. Now the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May God bless it for our hearing and understanding. At the end of a worship service, when a friend of mine had preached a sermon that addressed a pressing and controversial topic, one of his church members greeted him at the back doors with these words, "I come to church to feel good and happy." That was not a happy sermon. My friend who pastors a church that in many ways is very much like Fifth Avenue replied, "I'm not sure the point of worshiping God is so that we can feel good and happy. Perhaps we should talk about that sometime." Sometime later, when he shared the story and the two of us were talking about this end of worship interaction, my friend said he felt this gentleman represented not only a significant portion of his congregation, but also at American churches in general. I fear he is right. You know, there was a time when preachers were expected to, quote, step on people's toes when delivering a sermon. By that, folks meant that the sermon was something that was supposed to catch your attention, to make you think twice about something, to face something maybe you didn't want to face, or to have your thinking or faith challenged in some way. Not only was that type of preaching, stepping on people's toes, tolerated, to a certain extent, it was expected. Today, my friend and I feel that many of our pastor friends, when preaching, feel that they have to walk on eggshells, to use another metaphor, to speak very carefully because church members are easily offended these days. In the year 1518, Ulrich Zwingli convinced the city council at Zurich, Switzerland, to reform the city's churches. He was the priest at the Grossmünster, which meant great church in the city. This was the year after Martin Luther had begun the Protestant Reformation. Zwingli, like Luther, had been reading deeply into the New Testament and was convinced that the Christian church needed serious, significant reforms. Zwingli wanted to bring those reforms to the city of Zurich. He radically changed worship, the Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper, as we would call it. He changed from the sacrifice of Jesus' body to a memorial, a time where we remember Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection. Zwingli removed all the statuary in his, what was then, a Catholic church. The Mother Mary, the disciples, the Madonna and Child. He took out the stained glass windows. He removed the organ. He changed worship, what today we might experience somewhat like a worship service at a Catholic church, into a two-hour Bible study. Zwingli was convinced that studying the Bible was the key to reforming the Christian church, and that preaching the Bible was the way to get there. But when he changed a worship service of music and art and prayer and communion into a two-hour sermon about the Bible, well, to use another cliche or metaphor, he threw out the baby with the bathwater. And as you might imagine, people were eventually bored by two-hour sermons, especially when it replaced beautifully sung music. Attendance began dropping, so much so that the city council passed a resolution, a law, that required everybody to go to worship at least once a quarter. You would have thought this might have been a clue to Zwingli, maybe I did a little bit too much of this change. But there's a reason that there are Lutherans today, named after Martin Luther, and Calvinists, named after John Calvin, but there are no Zwingliists. Zwingli was brilliant, but he made more enemies than friends. 13 years after he began the Reformation in Switzerland, he was killed on a battlefield fighting Catholic soldiers. Now, he's important to us, because you could call him the grandfather to Baptists, a name and tradition this church clings to. The Mennonites came out of his church, out of his reformations, and 100 years later, the Mennonites influenced the first people who became Baptists. In a few weeks, we're going to celebrate communion, and the way we celebrate communion will be largely the way Zwingli wrote his theology 500 years ago. And though none of us, thankfully, would tolerate a two-hour sermon and nothing else in worship, Zwingli started this emphasis on preaching that would become a Baptist tradition for worship. So after these two stories, I want to ask you, what do you want out of a sermon? Why do you come to worship? The passage we read a few moments ago from Jeremiah records his call from God to become a prophet. One of the interesting parts, which Rachel mentioned in the children's sermon, is that Jeremiah sensed this call very early in his life, to an extent that his reply to God is, "I'm still a boy." The complaint doesn't register with God. God will tell him where to go, what to do, and what to say. God is not interested in age or experience or credentials. God looks for faithfulness. Was this particular to Jeremiah? Or is God a no resume, no college degree employer? Well, that's a sermon for another day, but worth thinking about. At least in Jeremiah's case, this was key to his ministry, that he was called by his own faithfulness, not by any credentials that he had. In this short passage, God tells Jeremiah what he is to say. He gives him a synopsis of what his message for his life will be. There are three lines to the call. The middle line is a repetition of the first line, which is typical in ancient Hebrew poetry, and it plays an important part in this call. This poetry lines up like an X, if you look at it in your Bibles. The first line, the first phrase of the first line matches up with the right side of the last line, creating a diagonal. And the first part of the right side of the line matches up with the left side of the first line, the second diagonal. The repetition in the middle, of course, is the blank space where the diagonals cross. So, what is the message of this X, this poetry X? Jeremiah is to pluck up and to plant. He is to tear down and to build up. Two metaphors, one agricultural, one architectural. Same message. Now, if you read the complete book of Jeremiah, which is a bit of a work, it's a long book. If you read the book of Jeremiah, there's a whole lot of plucking up and tearing down. He doesn't get to the planting and the building till later in his book. Jeremiah's ministry was about deconstructing theology. Deconstructing theology and beliefs and the status quo of the religious community of Jerusalem in his lifetime. And about reconstructing their theology, their beliefs, and a new narrative for a new day. Jeremiah's call, for much of my life, much of my career, has served as a preaching model to me. My career as a minister has been spent in this age when the Christian church in America is in significant decline. It's been my calling to pluck up and to plant, to tear down and to build. But because I'm Baptist, it's not my job to pluck up and plant for you. That's for you to do for yourself. Let me explain what I mean by that. If you have been with one of your friends to a Catholic worship service, or really to an Episcopal or Lutheran worship service, you will find that the liturgy around communion is the most important thing in the service, and it tends to be the longest part of the service because the Eucharist, taking communion, is the main thing. That's why you go to worship in a Catholic congregation, to receive communion. And when you are given the communion wafer, you are to swallow it whole, all of it. It's a great Christian tradition. But we Baptists have a different tradition. In Baptist churches, the sermon is the longest part of the service because Baptists think that understanding the Bible is the most important part of the service. But unlike communion, unlike the communion wafer, you are not supposed to swallow a sermon whole. When you take a sermon, you are supposed to chew on it for a while. Maybe for the rest of the day. Maybe into the week. But certainly for as long as the worship service is continuing. Now, it's okay if you want to spit some of it out. or the whole thing for that matter, but only after you've chewed on it for a while. Some of you may remember Buddy Sheridan, who was Fifth Avenue Baptist's interim pastor 50-some years ago when I was a child. He, at that time, he was professor at Southern Seminary in Louisville, and in his book, Four Fragile Freedoms, he would call this chewing on a sermon Bible freedom. That in this Baptist tradition that we cling to, that we hold on to, that has nurtured our faith, in this Baptist tradition, taking a sermon means to wrestle with the ideas from a Bible passage that the preacher has already wrestled with. And how you wrestle with them may be different than how the preacher wrestled with them, because, after all, the pastor and everyone else in the congregation, we're all different people. My job ends as preacher as your job as listener begins. It's my job to deeply read Scripture, to work at understanding the times in which we live, to think about and pray about this congregation and what God may be saying to it, and to put together a sermon in all those intersections. But once the words leave my mouth, I give them to God. You see, I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching with you. Because we are on a journey together to try to understand God and what God may be saying to us. And once the words of the sermon leave my mouth, I give them to God, and the Holy Spirit, we believe, gives them to you. And what you hear, what you process in your mind and in your soul, what you hear may or may not be the words I'm saying. I've had the experience many times. Some will be back, "Tim, that was a great sermon. I just love that sermon. And here's why it meant so much to me." And I'm thinking, "Did you hear anything I said?" But I give the words to God, and then the Holy Spirit gives them to you, and you hear them through your own lens, right? We take a sermon from our experiences as people. Young, old, male, female, Asian, black, white, rich, poor, happy, sad, all the things that make us who we are. This moment in time, which maybe is a great moment in your life or a terrible moment in your life, all those experiences are the filters by which we hear, by which we take a sermon. We hear things differently because we have different experiences as people. And what the preacher says will have different meanings to different people because of who they are as people. When I give the Holy Spirit the sermon I'm preaching, I am content to let the Spirit blow where the Spirit goes. How Jeremiah preached, plucking up and planting, shaped how I have thought about sermons and preaching sermons for decades. If I have done my work in prayer and in love for this congregation and in seeking God's truth in Scripture, then I'm content to let the Spirit blow where it blows. I'm hoping that in these months together, when I'm with you, and in the months in the future with a new pastor, that you're not asking, "Well, I don't think Tim's right about that. Oh, I don't think our new pastor's right about that. I hope you're not thinking whether you like or dislike the sermon, because the sermon is not about the preacher." Let me just be the first to tell you, I am not infallible. If anybody had any illusions about that, I am not infallible. I have been wrong, and I will be wrong in the future. But that doesn't matter because the sermon is not about me. It's not about my beliefs or what I think. I've never really understood why people leave churches because they don't agree with their pastor. Why is that important? I mean, when each of us come to the end of our lives, if there is a judgment and we're to respond to God, God's not going to say, well, did you believe like your pastor? No. Why does it matter what the pastor believes or thinks in a Baptist church, right? Because all of us are supposed to be working on our relationship with God. What I believe and think is irrelevant. As long as I am providing my work as a pastor to get you thinking and praying and working on your own faith, if I'm doing that, my beliefs are irrelevant. In fact, I don't want you to believe like me. I want you to wrestle with the ideas I bring in a sermon. And then for you to believe like you. I'm hoping that when you take a sermon, you're wondering, what is God saying to me in these words? If I find myself agreeing with this sermon, with these words that are being preached, what is that saying about me? What does this mean for my faith development? If I find myself struggling with these words, but agitated by these words, what does this struggle mean for my faith and my development as a Jesus follower? Where is God as I take this sermon? I hope in the sermons that I preach while I'm here at Fifth Avenue, God will use me to at least do one of two things. To comfort the afflicted, and to afflict the comfortable. So for people who are down or discouraged or doubting or depressed, I hope that when they take a sermon from me, that they will be able to find something that speaks to them, that quiets their soul, that gives them a sense that God's steadfast love is for them, that God loves them, whatever is going on in their life. And God will walk with them through whatever challenges they face. Comfort for the afflicted. And for people who are comfortable, who have grown stale in their faith or satisfied in their life, I hope that when they take a sermon, they are unsettled, disturbed, even provoked into engaging God in new ways that gets their faith out of a rut and into something new that God is taking them on. If, in fact, after a few months of being with you, some of you say that you have loved all my sermons, then I will feel I have failed you. If I haven't unsettled or provoked you at least a few times, then I haven't helped you pluck up what has grown stale in your life or in your faith. Let me circle back to Zwingli for a moment. There was a problem when Zwingli was changing the worship service in Zurich from a traditional medieval Catholic service to essentially a two-hour Bible study, and it wasn't about being boring. The problem was twofold. First, he believed that faith is cerebral. That simply by teaching, thinking about God, you can make it to God. But our experience with God is more than thinking. While Baptists think the sermon may be the most important part of worship, it's not the only part of worship. God is speaking to us through music and through prayers and through the fellowship here, and even from the architecture in this sanctuary. From everything that we experience from the time we walk into this sanctuary, how we are welcomed, all of those are speaking to us. Because faith is not just a head thing. It's also a heart thing and a soul thing. It's every part of us. But more importantly, Zwingli thought that he had the answers to give to the people in Zurich. Friends, we are in this faith journey together. Preaching a sermon and taking a sermon are equally important. For those of you on the pastor's committee, stay away from any preacher that believes he or she has all the answers about God. In fact, run away as fast as you can in the opposite direction. You already experience God. The pastor, the preacher, may have more degrees and may have studied the Bible more than you, but the preacher hasn't experienced God more than you. You are capable to chew on a sermon. Don't swallow it yet. Chew on it through your own experiences with God until you hear from God what needs to be plucked up and what needs to be planted, until you have tasted what God is revealing to you. Why do you attend worship? What do you want out of a sermon? Surely it's more than just to feel good and happy, as the gentleman said to my friend at the end of their worship service. Aren't we here because we hope to encounter the living God of Jesus Christ? Aren't we here in hopes that God will pluck up what has grown stale in us and plant a seed of a new beginning? May it be so. Amen. We end our worship service in this Baptist tradition of offering an invitation hymn. In a moment, as we're singing 391, Sweet, Sweet Spirit, we open our doors of fellowship. Maybe you've loved God for a long time, but you've never committed yourself to following Jesus Christ as a disciple and love to be baptized in Christ's name. Or maybe you've been a Christian for a long time, but you're looking for a church home, and you feel like this is the place you want to belong. We would love to greet you and welcome you into our church family. I'll be down here by these front of the communion table while we all stand together and sing. All right, we need y'all to sit down for a minute because it's going to take a second. Yep. You want to introduce our folks? No, I'll do, okay. You got it. I got the mic going. So we got three people coming before us today to join our church family. And first, I want to introduce Josie Chapman and Jake Hamilton. They'll come on up. They come wishing to join our church fellowship and to become a part of Fifth Avenue from their previous faith experience from Jesus Christ. Should we wait Macy up next? And then,
all we've favor say aye.
Okay. All right. So let's say amen instead.
Amen.
Okay. All right. Everybody who agrees will welcome Josie and Jake in our church fellowship. Would you say amen?
Amen.
But that was a resounding amen. All right, Macy, come on up. So Macy comes forward professing her faith in Jesus Christ and wishes to be baptized in our congregation and to commit her life to following Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. If you welcome Macy into this church family, would you also say amen?
Amen.
Man, that was a tie. I was going to say, like, who got the biggest amen, like they sometimes do in like TV shows or whatever, but that was like a tie. Macy, thank you so much for desiring to follow Christ and to make this lifelong commitment. This is a beginning. This will be a beginning. It's not an ending of a rich life in following Christ and having a life of faith. And we're glad that you trust us with this process. And Josie and Jake, we're so thankful that you want to be a part of this church family. And we ask that you would help us to be a better church. And we will do what we can to help you be better Christians. So, anything else we need to do? All right. Well, great. So yeah, mention one more time. Make sure you come Wednesday night. So after the benediction, please come down and speak with Josie and Jake and Macy and welcome them fully into our church family. Let's stand up for the benediction. Friends, as you go back out into the world, love God with your whole being, your heart, mind, and soul, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself, which means give yourself a break. And love your enemies. Love your enemies till they become friends so we can transform the world. And know as you go, the God, the creator of the universe, has already gone ahead of you, is already preparing a way for you. And that Jesus, the Christ, walks beside you every step of the way. And the Holy Spirit, God's love, is swirling around you to guide you and to protect you through all that you will face. So friends, go now in peace. Amen.